too.
I tell you, you don't feel the weightiness until you really kind of get up here. And if you were expecting someone else or wanted to hear someone else, you should have come to the 9 a.m. service, because then you would have got Pastor Terry. Pastor Terry, all he has to do is pull out a brown paper bag, and the anointing gets so thick, you're like, man, he didn't even pull it out till like 5 minutes left in his message. And I said, oh, come on, man. Help me out here. But I want to say thank you all for coming. I want to say welcome to our internet church. We have people watching all over West Virginia. We have people watching from Singapore in the Republic of Singapore, Arkansas, California, Delaware, Florida, Illinois, Indiana, Kentucky, Minnesota, Missouri, Nevada, New Jersey, Ohio, Pennsylvania, Texas, and Virginia. Would you make welcome the internet? Whew. And Pastor Darren and Miss Tammy are on vacation, and they're much needed, but be praying for them. In all honesty, I'm not 100% sure when they're due back, but can I tell you something? Even if he's not here Wednesday, you need to be here.
Amen.
Because we have staff members and people called that will fill this pulpit that have a word that you need to hear.
Amen.
So just because he's on vacation doesn't mean you need to stay home and watch TV. You need to be here. I'll be honest with you. You probably need to be here more when he's not here to show support to the ministry than it is. I'm just going to be. No, here's the deal. I know I'm preaching to the choir because you all are here when I'm speaking. But you need to encourage. You probably know people who stayed home because they heard Pastor Darren was on vacation. You need to tell them you missed out this morning. If they normally come to the 9 a.m., I'm telling you, you missed a word on kindness. If you're watching by internet and you normally come to 9 a.m., Pastor Terry, man, he tore it up with kindness. And when he pulled, like I said, I was hoping that brown paper bag would be here. I'd just pick it up and kind of pray the anointing would just fall, and I could. I mean, seriously, anytime he picks that thing up. But I'll be honest with you. I got a text message last Sunday night, and last weekend I was celebrating my brother's wedding. I had the privilege of baptizing my brother and his new wife, and doing their ceremony in North Carolina. But Sunday evening, all the family left, and Bethany and I had stayed an extra day because I had Monday off and thought we're going to spend some time with our kids on the beach. So we enjoyed each other. We just enjoyed the four of us on the beach Sunday. We had went out to dinner. Just wanted Outback. You know, we had done, you know, different seafoods or whatever, but we just wanted to do Outback. So you show up to dinner, and this is the way my wife and I do it. We set money aside for vacation. I take cash and don't plan on using my debit card. That way, I'm not hurting when I get back from vacation. I know this is, I have allotted this much money, so if that means I eat a $200 meal and I have to eat fast food for the rest of the time, that's what we do. So we had some money left over from our first vacation, then we went down to this wedding, and we get to Outback, and we eat, and we don't eat anything expensive. You know, I'm a $10 Outback special kind of guy. I'm all about cheap. It's steak. I put A1 on it. It all tastes the same to me. That's just me. I do quantity over quality because it all tastes like A1 before it's over. That's just me. You may not do that, but anything tastes better with A1. That's just my opinion. So for me, we get done eating and we go to pay. And Bethany reaches in her purse we had a $100 bill left that we knew this was for our last dinner. And the next morning we were going to get up, put gas in the car, and we were going to start our 9-hour trek home. So she looks down in her purse, and that $100 bill's not there. Now, $100 is not a dollar. I'll be honest with you. Sometimes I'd even cry over a dollar. Because if I want to drink out of the machine and all I got is 50 cents and it's $1.50, I want to cry for a dollar. But when it's $100, I mean, that's heartbreaking. That is heartbreaking money to me. And it just didn't set well. And here's the deal. My wife got a check that morning to hide her purse as they were coming in to clean our hotel room. And we did. But I don't know. I'm not saying I have a 2-year-old and an 18-month-old, or a 3-year-old and 18-month-old. I know little fingers get in purses. So I'm not saying that it couldn't have been misplaced. But I'll be honest with you, it just kind of rocked my boat a little bit. When you have expectation that this is going to be there Here's the deal. Had I known that that $100 was missing, I'd have probably picked somewhere else to eat or had chicken fingers instead of even the $10 steak dinner. That's just how we live, but we get to do what we want to. But it just started to rock the boat a little bit, so we went back to the hotel room, and Bethany was in a fluster, and we get there, and that evening she goes to put her contacts, take her contacts out, put her glasses on, and the glasses case with her glasses and the contact solution is missing. And she had pulled them out at the dinner table to look for the money, and then forgot to put them back. I mean, this storm just started brewing. So I call the restaurant. Well, it's Sunday evening and they close early, which is great. I hope they close early enough for people to get in church. But at this moment, I needed glasses and I wanted to roll out before they open at 11 or 12 the next day. So the next morning we get up, we end up finding her glasses. But it's enough to make you unsettled at a moment. And recently, I've had the privilege of starting to work at, and I call it a privilege. I get to work the Family Life Center. And if you're coming to the Reach the City meeting this evening, you're going to see me, because that is something that Pastor has asked me to help oversee with Pastor Bobby leaving. But as I said in the Family Life Center, I get the awesome opportunity to see saved and unsaved people come into our Family Life Center. And almost at least half will stop and talk. I'm a talker. If you know me for very long, I talk. That's probably why they give me a mic and say preach. But I like to talk, and I like to know people. And it doesn't take me very long to find out if they're in a storm or they're not, or maybe coming out of one. Because I've learned in life, there are three situations. You're either coming out of a storm, you're going into a storm, or you're in the middle of a storm. If you just came out of one, enjoy the peace, because before long, you're going to head right into another one. If you're in the middle of it, I got news for you. See, I'm going somewhere, because I'll be honest with you, as the Lord started to deal with me about storms, I'm like, man, that's kind of depressing. But then as I started to wrap things up, I'm like, oh, there's hope in the storm. There's hope in a storm. See, because I know I didn't get that $100 back, but I began to pray, Lord, if it was lost and someone picked it up, I pray you bless them with it. If it was stolen, I pray that the person who took it feel convicted when they go to spend it. Those are the storms. Those are small storms. This past Friday night, we took the food truck, and I did a small part. I did the prep work and tried to help people. But man, we took I call them the like motley crew. You know, your Jeremy, your Joey, Evan. Evan, when you showed up that night, I thought, man, oh, they don't know what's about to happen on Capitol Street. They took that thing down from 11:30 to about 2:30 Friday night into Capitol Street, Charleston. Okay. But we took people who, that had once been a stormy place. That had once been a place where it was unsettled. See, they thought it was settled. They thought it was settled with some sort of substance that they were going to put in their body. But see, when they showed up to pray right before they left, and they show up, and Jeremy McClanahan was the one that had this dream for it, and probably because he and Joey Cavender met bouncing bars on Capitol Street. And Jeremy said, years ago, I used to frequent these bars to give them service, to do a job or to even give them money in exchange for substance. But he went down to pray for those that were coming out of bars. We saw over 200 hot dogs and hamburgers given out, and over 100 people prayed for on Friday evening. That is absolutely amazing, and it doesn't matter what role you played on that food truck that night. I don't care if you wrapped a hamburger and never laid hands on somebody. You were a part of that. But the Lord started dealing with me about storms, and he took me to Jonah. And if you'd open up to Jonah chapter 1, it's a story that I've heard probably my entire life. And if you're new to church and you haven't heard Jonah, well, you're going to hear about Jonah today. It says, now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of A, I'm just going to call him A because I don't, the big words. Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry out against it, for their wickedness has come up before me. But Jonah arose to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. He went down to Joppa, found a ship going to Tarshish, so he paid the fare, went down into it to go with them to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. Now, I don't know how the Lord's spoke to Jonah. It said the word of the Lord came to Jonah. I don't know if this was an audible voice out of heaven. I don't know. But how many of you, when the Lord speaks to you, I love to hear Pastor Terry talk about it, whether it's behind a pulpit or in conversation or staff meeting, he'll start to get excited and go, ooh, it operates with me. And honestly, I really want to look, I wish I could get a little, I could see in to know what that's like. Because I've heard it for 30 years, you going, that operates with me. And I'm like, I get a feeling, but I'd really like to know what Pastor Terry's sensing at that point. Spend any time with him. You'll hear him say it. Ooh, it operates with me. So Jonah has this word from God to go to Nineveh, a great city. And the instruction is simple. Go to Nineveh and preach the word. See, the instruction is simple, but Jonah got a little scared and decides to head in the opposite direction. So Jonah's told to go one way, and I really feel like God had like a do not enter sign, wrong way. And Jonah just decided to blow right past that because that was not his thing. But he went to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. I mean, think about that. From the we encourage people to get in the presence. But here's this man who was given a word, and what he wants to do is run from it because you think the task is too great. So in disobedience, in absolute disobedience, he decides to go the other way. And I thought, Lord, have I missed things just by being disobedient? Have I caused storms in my life because of a simple act of disobedience? All Jonah had to do, he didn't have some sermon planned out. The Lord just said, go and cry out. I mean, he may have just had a prayer service. I don't know. But it was just simple instruction, but it was so daunting. He decided to go the wrong way, out of the presence of the Lord. So verse 4, he gets in the boat, and all of a sudden there's a mighty tempest. A great, great storm begins to blow about. And you know, as we were singing, I mean, it's funny how the Lord just gives you stuff as you're being a part of the worship and getting involved and just loving on our Savior. But this is a side note because you could really probably have an entire message with this, but he was supposed to cry out to Nineveh to repent. But in the process, his destiny, his obedience or disobedience affected either a great city or a small boat of people. The moment he got on that boat, a storm came up. And that storm was not because of the other people on the boat. That storm was because of Jonah's disobedience. And my side note here is, you need to be careful on who you allow to have tickets to your boat. Just because God gave you a word and it seems like a cool place to be for others, that may not be where they're supposed to be. And when you bring them onto your boat, you cause more harm for you than you ever thought. They didn't think anything of it when Jonah bought the ticket. They didn't think anything of it. They just said, okay, you're going the same place we are. These guys, when they got into the midst of it, they began to cry out to their gods. So they weren't saved. You know, I don't know why they were going to Tarshish. All I know is Jonah wasn't supposed to be there. And because he got on their boat, all of a sudden they were all in a storm. And I go, Lord, what are you trying to say? And it was when you run from the presence of God or disobey his commands, you're going to encounter storms. And those storms will affect those around you. When's the last time you were in a storm and you're the only one that got wet? I mean, think about it. In a real storm, even if you put an umbrella up, you still going to have wet. Unless you've got my messenger pants, Pastor Andy, you are going to get your pants wet. If you don't know what messenger pants are and you've never seen me wear them, don't worry about it. I wouldn't see JD. JD's just sitting there calm and collected. We had this conversation. But you're going to get wet. Your shoes are going to get wet. I don't care how nice they are. In a storm, you're going to get wet and people around you are going to get wet. And so they begin, all these mariners begin to cry out to their gods. What is happening? You know, what are we going to do? And Jonah's asleep in the boat. And they wake him up and say, hey man, cry out. And then they cast lots. And I don't believe it's by chance the Lord let it be known, even in that moment, who this storm was about. So Jonah then had to confess and say, I've left the presence of the Lord. And because of my disobedience, now all of us are in trouble. So he looks at him and he says, just throw me overboard. Now, I like the ocean, but Pastor Terry pointed out in the first service, there's been 8 or 9 people, or 7 people, bitten in North Carolina beaches this year. And he wasn't real sure about going to the beach a few weeks ago because he didn't want number 8 to be him. Yeah, you know what? Pastor Terry, I'm with you. I was trying to, you know, baptize my brother and praying, Jesus, please let my legs be okay. I know that's, hey, I didn't want 9, 10, and 11 to be me, him, and his bride. I just didn't want that to happen. But Jonah says, throw me overboard. And honestly, and this is just me, I believe when they threw him overboard, they threw him in the direction of Nineveh. I believe that when they threw him overboard, what they were doing is throwing him in the direction he was initially supposed to go. Because the moment he started in the right direction, getting off the boat that was heading away, the storm stopped. All because of disobedience. And so I thought, Lord, we've got a church full of people. Obviously, they're obedient. And they still go through storms. I'm not saying everybody's obedient, but I believe that we're trying as a church, and I hope you're trying as a people to hear the voice of God and obey. So he took me over to Matthew chapter 14. And this is where Jesus had just fed 5,000 men and then the women and children. So he gives his disciples instructions. And this is starting in verse 22. He gives his disciples instructions. It says, immediately Jesus made his disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side while he sent the multitudes away. Here is the living, breathing word of God. And he gives simple instruction. See, I believe God speaks in ways that the most intelligent man on the planet and the most unintelligent man on the planet can understand the voice of God. I believe that's why he spoke to fishermen and tax collectors and Pharisees. That's just me. I don't believe you have to have some big doctorate degree to understand the word of God. I think if you get into it, he'll make it known to you in the way you understand it. You know, and if that is a Precious Moments Bible because you're new, then speak through a Precious Moments Bible. That's just, so here's the word of God. He's just preached. He's just fed. He's taken loaves and fishes to feed 5,000. And he says, get in the boat and go to the other side while I send the people away. They're obedient. But a few verses later, in verse 24, the disciples says, we'll start at 22. Immediately Jesus made his disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side while he sent multitudes away. And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. Now when evening came, he was alone there. Verse 24, but the boat was now in the middle of the sea, tossed by waves, for the wind was contrary. And obedience. You would think, I'm obedient. Storms shouldn't come my way. Now remember, you're either going in, you're in the middle of, or you're coming out of a storm. And here they were, they didn't realize when they got on the boat, it probably looked clear as day. And the moment they launch out, being obedient to the word of the Lord, storm. And this is really what hit me Friday evening, because the plan was to meet here between 10 and 10:30 and be out there by 11. But the group of guys, some of the guys that had went, were planning on going on the food truck, got a phone call that there was a brother in the middle of a storm. So they were an hour late because they stopped at his house and prayed. I was okay with that. I mean, I waited for an hour, but I did some work to make sure when they got there, all they had to do was get in a truck and go. And I believe that this, I don't believe, I know, I've seen this guy be obedient. He comes to church anytime he can, lays on the altar, but there are still storms. You ask the Cavenders, when they bring in someone who's trying to get off drugs, you know, when they're on drugs, they're addicted, all they can think about is where the next fix is, and that's one storm. But here they are trying to get off of it, and they're going through this thing called withdrawals. It's still a storm, but they're doing what God has actually called them to do, and that's get off the addiction. See, we want to think that being obedient means we're going to bypass every storm. Most of the time, the moment you're obedient is the moment you find yourself in the middle of a storm. So whether you're disobedient like Jonah, or whether you're obedient like the 12, storms are coming. But here's where the turnaround is, and this is why I got so excited sitting at my dinner table yesterday, because as I read both passages of Scripture, at some point, the storm stopped. When Jonah got off the boat heading the wrong way, which the way I view it is he was taking his first steps towards the right place, towards the presence of God, his storm and the storm for those around him ended. And then if we read on in Matthew chapter 14, verse 32, Jesus, we always get in this passage and we talk about Peter walking on water and Jesus having to pull him out. But in verse 32, it says, when Jesus, got on the boat, the wind ceased. When they got back into the presence of the Lord, storms stopped. And we come in here and we wonder why everything seems calm, cool, collected. You know, I can feel the presence of the Lord. I can experience it. Oh, I can worship freely. And all of my troubles seem to be okay. And I'm getting over them and I'm making leaps and bounds. But we go home and the first thing we do is get back into some sort of storm. You know what the Lord told me? Those things that you used to, I'm a music guy. I have a massive music collection. And most of them are Christian. But this is what he told me when we were standing up here singing. See, when certain songs begin to flow in an atmosphere, it takes me to a place. And whether you realize it or not, if you still have things hanging around your house that were around when you were in a storm, you wonder why that storm is still in your house. It's because you haven't got rid of the stuff that was in that storm with you. See, here's the deal. I love all kinds of music. But you wonder why when you hear certain songs, that urge to put a pill in your mouth, that's because that's the song you were listening to the last time you put a pill in your mouth. The last time you put a needle in your arm, what music was playing? What was on the TV? And you wonder, that's because it's not happening in the church, but you haven't cleaned your home out. Jonah's boy, the mariners, they were tossing stuff off. They didn't know what was causing it. What was causing the storm? Maybe it's things on here. Let's just get it off the boat. You wonder why your home's a mess? Clean it out. You wonder why there's peace here? That's because we pray over this sanctuary. There's prayer going on all the time. There's burn on Thursday nights. There's pre-service prayer. It creates an atmosphere where storms dissipate, where things are allowed to happen. When you walk in and your storm, but you go home and that cloud. The next time, when you go home this afternoon, walk in your house, and if you just feel it, creep in, go, okay, Lord, show me what was here, what I allowed to cause a storm. Because I want the presence. And if I have to get something out for the presence of and God and the peace of God to be in my home, I'll get rid of every movie I own. I'll get rid of every CD I own. I'll change my cell phone to where I can't get internet, but I'll just get talk and text. You wonder. Trust me, these are things that I have to check myself on daily. The staff wasn't born behind pulpits. There are things that I did that I'm not proud of, but I have to shut the door to that because I want the presence of God to be in my family. And the moment Peter got back on the boat with Jesus, the storm stopped for everybody. For everyone. And I sat and go, Lord, what are you trying to say to me? What are you trying to teach me? And these were things that the Lord showed me as I was dealing with storms. Because I'll be honest with you, man, some storms, I'd like to say they're only like 2 or 3 days. Some of them can be 2 and 3 years to get into the true place where you're supposed to be. And that's not to scare you. There's lessons to be learned in the storm. I guarantee Peter learned a lesson never to take his eyes off Jesus in the middle of that storm. I can promise you. I can bet. I know Jonah went on. He got angry with God, but I bet he never left the presence even when he was arguing. He knew what it was like to be away from the presence. There were storms away from the presence. But when there was obedience, this is what I love. When there was obedience, Jesus came. When there was disobedience, there was a whale. I would much rather Jesus get on my boat and the storm stop rather than me to get having to the belly of a big fish for 3 days. I mean, you know he was stinking all kinds of sorts when that was over. But this is what the Lord told me to notice about these two storms. One storm was from disobedience. And one storm came in a time of complete obedience. But it tells us that storms are coming. There will be storms no matter what. The enemy is going to try to bring things in. And if you're disobedient, this is another thing. When you're disobedient, it says that the Lord allowed, I believe in Jonah, it says that the Lord caused a mighty wind and a tempest on the sea. We like to give the devil a whole lot of credit for a storm we're walking through when it was our own disobedience. I'm sure Jonah was like, yeah, the devil coming against me. No, he's not. I mean, I hear it all the time. Hear it all the time. Oh, the devil coming against me. When's the last time you were obedient? Because either the enemy's going to come against you because you're being obedient, or the Lord may allow things to happen to get you into obedience because you're out of obedience. Both storms stopped when the presence began to enter in. When the presence entered in, or when Jonah took off towards the presence, storms ceased. We hear pastors say all the time, get in your secret place. The best way to dispel a storm is to spend time in the presence. Now, I'm not saying that the storm will be over when you come out of your closet. But you'll find peace in the middle of it while you're there. It won't be over just like that. But the presence of the Lord. Nicole was speaking to the worship team, I believe it was after soundcheck this morning, and changing our perspective and how we look at things. And, you know, the Spirit of the Living God, Spirit of the Living, we sing songs about it. But do we really invite it in to allow it to change us and to change the atmosphere around us? Because unless we do, then we're just singing songs about it. Then we're just talking about it. I don't want to just talk about it. I want to know it. And probably up until Jonah actually experienced it and experienced this, he probably just, he knew the presence of the Lord, but he didn't know. Because you can come in and you can experience it, but you may not know it. And you can look around and you can, you know, I can look at Debbie and Frank Tettenburn and think, wow, what a storm they just walked through. But when I stand beside him and I hear him sing, there's peace. I don't understand it, but I sit and go, oh, okay. Okay. I have the best seat in the house because I get to see when the Lord starts to work. I get to see the facial expressions change. When the presence really starts to do a work, you can see it. I really wish sometimes there was a video camera here to where you all, when the Lord really got a hold of you, the next time you were in a storm, that we could play a video of, let me just take you back to a place where the presence was allowed to intervene, where the presence was allowed to show up, and let me show you the peace of God that rested on you in this moment. But we've got to remember. And we've got to do our part to make sure that we are in an atmosphere where the presence can come. And so most of the time, that's in an atmosphere of a storm. And this is what I've noticed in churches. We're in the middle of a storm, and they come in. Somebody gets a bad report, cancer, going through divorce, whatever. They come in, they lay on the altar for 2 or 3 weeks. They go to the doctor, their cancer's gone, in remission, whatever, and they're gone until the next bad report. Then they come in. We need to learn how to keep that atmosphere. We need to learn how to keep, in it, when there's storms, when there's peace. See, we want Jesus in a storm, but when it's peace, when it's peaceful, we want to put him on a shelf so we can do what we want to do. We want to do what we want to do. And then the moment we get back, the waves get a little high and it gets a little rocky, we want to go pull them off the shelf again, and we want to come back and say, okay, Lord, please get me out of this storm. Please get me out of this storm. You know, the reason your marriage is working right now is because both of you are in church. Both of you are hearing the word of God. Both of you are coming in and getting fed. And then you leave and you wonder, why is there animosity in my marriage? That's because you've got out of the presence. You know, when I come in, I don't think about the drugs that I used to do. I don't think about the videos of immoral videos that I used to watch. I don't think about this, and I don't think about that. That's because you're in the presence. And we have to do a better job when we're home and when we're out and when we're... Man, Friday night, my prayer was, Lord, let the presence fall on Capitol Street. Because it was either going to be the presence of God flow out of that truck and off those people onto the people into in Capitol Street, or and I told Jeremy this. I said, you got to take your big guns. You got to take your sergeants in the kingdom. You can't take ones that are riding the fence. Because there's going to be two presences in that area, and if they're not strong, then that dark presence is going to overtake the kingdom of light, and that's not what we want. We want to go dispel the darkness. We want to send the presence up Capitol Street. And we can jump, we can cheer, we can shout about it, but what's even your home life like? We want to go see the lost saved on Capitol Street, but your home's a mess because you can't clean it up to allow the presence to flow. And that goes for anybody. Yeah. Amen. I don't care what title, position, non-position you hold. We all have to get up daily and say, Lord, I want your presence today. Yeah. I want to wake up with it. I want to go to sleep with it. I want to sleep while it's all around me and my wife. I want it to infiltrate my kids' rooms. Yeah. I pray over my children every night. I plead the blood of Jesus over them every morning, every night before I go to bed, because I want the presence to flow in my home. So, JD and Nicole, I'm about to wrap up. But my point with all the storm is it doesn't last. I'll be honest with you, man. Sometimes I hear things about, oh, I've been in a storm. And I know storms can be lengthy and storms can be short. But storms do end. We've got to change the mindset that we're going to be in a storm for the rest of our lives. Miss Becky, there are people that come in, and please forgive me, but I'm just going to be honest. There are people that we get emails from daily of sickness. And I'm like, man, just begin to speak healing over. I mean, come on. Quit speaking that, oh, this one's sick and that one's sick, and it's the same people daily. And I'm like, man, if they could just get a hold of the fact that if they'd start speaking healing and speaking, I bet, Shandy, I bet that there wasn't a thing allowed in your room that wasn't of the most godly and positive, that you are going to be whole, that you are going to be well. Why? Because I've spent time with you and Kelly. I know what you're about. But we've got people that we want to stay in the storm. I think there are people that have gotten comfortable there. That's how they identify themselves. I'm always sick. I'm always this. I'm always that. And God said, man, it's time to come out of that. It's time to identify as I'm not below, but I'm above. I'm the head. I'm not the tail. I'm not sick. I am whole. I am well. I am not addicted. I am delivered. Those are storms that you could overcome if you just begin to profess it. If you would just begin to speak the goodness, watch the atmosphere change. If you'd stand to your feet this morning, I'm going to ask, if you're going through a storm, if you're in the middle of a storm, if you just come out of a storm, or maybe you realize you haven't been in a storm for a few and you're probably getting ready to head back into one. This altar's open. And the Lord spoke to me. The Lord spoke to me when we were celebrating this guy who got saved today. Because I don't know what storm you're in. You may not be saved, and you may be sitting there struggling today. Do I get saved? A few weeks ago, I remember Pastor gave an altar call, and there was some people that he said, I believe there's more people need to get saved. And I remember watching this one individual could barely contain themselves to get out and almost run to the altar. And the Lord spoke to me and said, Joey, there's nothing special about the prayer that they pray here. He said, if they died in the run down, I would accept them, because the moment they made a decision to step out, they were saved. And I believe, Jay, I believe, Chris, yeah, it's good to do prayer, and that's why we do it, because it just kind of affirms with people. I'm not saying that there's not, but there is no magic in a sinner's prayer. It's in a heart condition. So when the guy drove off Canal Terrace and said, I'm getting it right, I believe the moment, and I believe we went through the things we needed to make sure we can get in touch with him and pray with him and lead in God. But I believe the moment he pulled off the parking lot and had made a decision in his mind and his heart, I believe his storm was coming to an end, at least that one. Because he was stepping into obedience. We have altar workers that'll pray with you. We have staff that'll pray with you. I don't know what your storm is, but I know that there are people dealing with storms. I know it. And you say, well, how do you know it? Because God's moving in this place, and when he moves on his people, the enemy wants to do nothing more than to interrupt that move. And if he can't do it as a collective body, he'll come after you personally. He'll make you think you're alone. He'll make you think nobody cares. But I'm telling you today, there are people who care about you. There are people who love you, and they want to pray for you. They want to encourage you. They want to love you, because that is what the body is called to do. So as Nicole and JD sing and play, I'm going to ask you this morning to come and allow the Lord to reveal himself in a way that you will not go home the same person. And when you get home and you realize there's things in your home that are a conduit for a storm to brew, that it would be revealed to you to get rid of. And that may be an expensive piece of something. It may have cost you an arm and a leg. But the Lord says, don't let the price tag cause you to not get rid of it, because it will cost you more in the long run. It will cost you more than a price tag can ever be put on it. And I'm also going to give you instruction. Don't try to sell it. Because if it was an open conduit for you, you don't want it to be a stumbling block for someone who put money in your pocket to take it out of your house. You say, well, that may be old-fashioned. Well, years ago when I was in youth, we brought our secular CDs, and I'm not against secular CDs, but some secular CDs you need to get rid of because there's some wrong things on there. But instead, before we even put them in the trash, we broke them. You want to know why? I've watched the trash men go through my trash to get my old shoes. And if those CDs weren't appropriate for my home, I didn't want them to pick it up and go, wow, I like this artist, and throw it in there. Keep it for him. It will cost you more. Jonah getting on a boat in disobedience cost all those mariners probably valuable fishing equipment, clothing. It's going to cost you something. So this morning, I'm going to ask you to come. And if you want prayer, if you want someone to agree with you, if you just raise your hand, we've got staff and altar workers that will come and pray with you, agree with you, as the Lord, just allow the Lord to move the next few moments.
I'll praise you in this storm. I will lift my hands, for you are who you are. No matter where I am, every tear I've cried, you hold in your hand. You've never left my side, though my heart is torn.
Y'all get that. I know you have a word as far as you believe you've heard from God on some direction in your life. I know you have, and I know you're doing your best, but there's been some storms. There has been storms, but I do believe you're doing what you're supposed to. I know you're doing your best to seek the will of God, but I do. I look back there and I, just because of who my mother-in-law is, I know a little bit of the hurt and a little bit of the obstacle. But I can see it. I can see the weightiness. And I feel like we're supposed to pray for you this morning. Is that okay? And Papa Joe, I'm going to have you come up here. I'm going to have you. Pastor Jay, you have any anointing oil? I'm going to have you anoint him, Pastor Jay. And then, Joe, I'm going to have you. They have a call that they are doing their best to try to get to. And they've met some storms along the way. So church, as a body, I'm gonna ask you to stretch your hand forth and agree with Joe as he prays. Joe, however the Lord leads you, I want you to.
Heavenly Father, sometimes we go the other direction. Sometimes we move in ways that we don't understand ourselves. Father, I know that these two are looking, they're searching. They're struggling to do what you want them to do in their hearts. Father, we prayed with them. We love them. This whole church needs to put their hands out. We all need to say, help us, Lord, to see clearly Help us to understand the direction. Help us to move. Help us to hear your still small voice. Help us to ignore that which is pushing us in a different direction. Help us to ignore our own feelings and the values which we have ingrained so deeply inside of us from the time we're young. Help us to just move past all that and to look into your eyes. Help us to understand fully that it's your lap that you want us to be in. Father, I just pray right now for this couple. I pray that their hearts would be one and that their faces would point toward you, the wave walker, that they would look past all the waves. Father, there's things that are blockades in the way many, many times that we feel like are just too hard to overcome. But if we can just keep our eyes on your liquid eyes of love, if we can just understand that you have got it all in the palm of your hand, if we can just lay back into your hand, you will guide us. You will take us safely home. So I pray right now that you would give them full understanding in their hearts. I pray you would give them wisdom. I pray that they would see more clearly. And I pray, Father, that their eyes would not be adjusted to that which discourages, to that which just pulls apart away from, but their eyes would be focused on you constantly. Because when they stay there, all of a sudden we find ourselves where you want us to be. So I pray right now that their hearts, that their minds, that all their lives would stay close to you, would not see the distraction, but would look past the distraction into your eyes, knowing that you're going to guide them into the exact place that they need to be. With blessings, Father, we say to them, step out of the boat and continue walking. Continue focusing upon the eyes of Jesus, and the presence will take you where you're supposed to be. With the blessings of all of us. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah.
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for this day. Can you just lift your hands and give him praise for what he's done in this house, how he's moved? Lord, I thank you. Lord, I thank you and I praise you, Lord, for this opportunity that you've blessed me with. Lord, I pray that it would not return void, but Lord, I pray that if there was anything I spoke out of line, Lord, that you would let them know, Lord, I'm human, but Lord, I pray that the word out of my mouth this morning, Lord, was what you wanted. And Lord, if there was any flesh in it, Lord, I pray that you would forgive me of that this morning. Because Lord, I was just I'm trying to do what I believe you've called me to do, try to speak what I believe you've asked me to speak. And Lord, I pray you go with this group of believers here today. Lord, I pray that you would bless them, Lord, as they spend time with their families this afternoon. Lord, I pray they would get back this evening, Lord, to hear the word of God be preached. Lord, no matter who the vessel is, no matter what the word is, Lord, they need to be in the presence. And Lord, I pray we press out this evening to get here. Lord, that we would come to exalt your name and to see what you want to do in this place. And we give you all praise. We give you all honor. In Jesus' name, amen. You are dismissed.